Thank you. The next item of business is a debate in motion 10343 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on equality within the 2023-24 programme for government. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in this debate to please press the request to speak buttons. I call on Shirley Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 13 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Tackling poverty and protecting people from harm is one of the three critical missions for this government, alongside our focus on growing the economy and strengthening public services. It is these interconnected missions that are front and centre of this year's programme for government, which is unapologetically anti-poverty, focused on delivering high-quality public services. And it shows that we can alleviate inequality and poverty by ensuring we have a fair, green and growing well-being economy that provides job opportunities and capitalises on a just transition. This government will continue to use our fixed budget to reduce poverty, improve opportunities and reduce health inequalities, protecting people as far as possible from the harm inflicted by the UK government's austerity-driven policies and the ongoing cost of the union crisis. However, it is only with the full economic powers of an independent nation that we can truly eradicate inequality and poverty here in Scotland. Presiding Officer, delivering fair work and fair pay for all is critical to our missions and a top priority for the Scottish Government. The NHS is the largest employer in Scotland, and through our Agenda for Change pay offer, we have ensured that NHS employees in the lowest bands have the biggest increases in pay. Building on this, we are committing to providing the necessary funding in the next budget to increase the pay of adult social care workers in the private, third and independent sectors in a direct care role and those working to deliver funded early learning and childcare to at least £12 per hour, an increase that could be worth up to £2,000 per year for those on full-time contracts. There are over 200,000 registered workers in the social care sector and 4 out of 5 of them are women. We know that women and child poverty are inextricably linked, so not only will this help recruit and retain in our social care workforce and in early learning and childcare, but it will also be a key step to tackling poverty for women and children.
Certainly.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking this intervention. Can I ask if it's still the case that the Scottish Government will stand by the First Minister's commitment in March for a new national funding framework for hospices as well in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm sure this is one of the aspects that the Cabinet Secretary for Health can deal with in his closing statement on this, but I do recognise that there are challenges that many hospices and indeed charities in the third sector are facing, and we are very keen to try and support where we can, but within the limited budget that we have. This government is committed to tackling the inequality that we have in our community. And, Presiding Officer, I only wish that the UK Government showed even a quarter of our ambition. The UK Conservative Government must face up to the damage and hardship it has caused by well over a decade of austerity and welfare cuts. Damage and hardship exacerbated by a hard Brexit and shocking mismanagement of the economy, which has led to soaring inflation, spiralling energy bills and the worst cost of living crisis in a generation. Now, this government is doing all it can in the face of that to make a difference. And despite the UK government's policies pushing people into poverty, we know that our action is still making a difference. Modelling estimates that 90,000 fewer children will live in relative and absolute poverty this year as a result of this government's policies, with the poverty levels 9 percentage points lower than they would have been otherwise. This includes lifting an estimated 50,000 children out of relative poverty through the Scottish Child Payment. Now, that is a major achievement, but that achievement would be all the more if we weren't being held back by the UK government policies pushing people into poverty at the same time. The UK government welfare policies, including the two-child limit and the benefit cap, inflict hardship on families on the lowest incomes. The two-child limit alone is affecting 80,000 children in Scotland and has removed £341 million from Scottish families since 2017. That is a disastrous policy for people right across this country at their time of greatest need. And were the UK government to reverse key welfare reforms introduced since 2015, This would help to lift 70,000 people out of poverty this year, including 30,000 children, putting an estimated £780 million back in the pockets of the lowest income households. Now, the Conservatives in Westminster must no longer sit by and watch people suffer, though they may feel that they can, because Labour are promising more of the same, which is why the powers over social security and employment, to name but two, are needed in the hands of this Parliament. But if the UK Government really wanted to do something to alleviate inequality, then it could. That's why the First Minister wrote to the Prime Minister yesterday calling for the UK Government to legislate to put an essentials guarantee in place to ensure that social security benefits adequately cover the cost of essentials, including food, transport, energy, and to ensure the deductions such as debt repayments to government, sanctions, or as a result of the benefit cap, can never pull support below this level. Now, we know that the Welsh Government also support this approach, and I will follow up with further correspondence to the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions in the coming days. Presiding Officer, over the last five financial years, we have invested £711 million through activities such as the discretionary housing payments and the Scottish Welfare Fund to mitigate the austerity of UK government policies, including the bedroom tax, the benefit cap and local housing allowance. This money could have been spent on services like health, education, transport, or on further ambitious anti-poverty measures. It could have paid for around 2,000 Band 5 nurses each year. That is the price of staying in the union. Now, however, Scotland cannot wait for the UK Government to act. While devolution continues to limit what we can do, this Government is determined to use our powers to the fullest possible extent. That's why, in 2021, we convened an expert group from across the third sector and academia and industry to look at how, under our current powers and within current budget challenges, Scotland can build steps towards a minimum income guarantee. Such a change could be transformational, and I look forward to receiving the group's recommendations in 2024. Now, we know that child poverty in particular lies at the roots of many of the greatest challenges we face as a country, including tackling health and educational inequalities. The Scottish Government is unequivocal in its commitment to meet our statutory targets through Best Start, Bright Futures. Delivering on our ambition will mean tough choices, and we will not shy away from the decisions needed to reduce poverty and support those who are in greatest need. Neither will we shirk from protecting people from harm, as outlined in our missions. Now, our programme for government sets out how we will work to deliver further progress on those shared ambitions. This includes investing £405 million in our unique and game-changing Scottish child payment this year. Worth £25 per eligible child per week, this payment is unique in the UK and was reaching over 316,000 children as of the end of June this year. That's more than £350 million paid to low-income families since the payment launched in February 2021. Now, to ensure we continue to support people with the cost of living, we are committed to increasing the Scottish Child Payment, Funeral Support Payment and all disability and carers benefits in line with inflation. Unlike UK benefit systems, I also have to stress that the Scottish Child Payment does not have a limit to the number of children who can qualify for a family. That's a principle based on dignity, which is a shame the Tories and the Labour Party have long since given up on. Building on our action to date, we have now set ambitious plans to expand access to high-quality funded childcare by the end of this Parliament, starting with those who need it most, helping tackle poverty and supporting thousands more parents to take up or sustain employment. Certainly.
Megan Gallagher.
The Cabinet Secretary might have saw some correspondence on social media last night from the private, voluntary and independent sector. They're not very happy with the government's proposals. They think that businesses will still close in the childcare sector. Can I ask what the Cabinet Secretary's response is to that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we will of course continue to work with those right across early learning and childcare, but I will take no lessons from the Tories, who want us to follow the UK government's approach, which is only restricted to children with parents who are working and who are not determined to pay the living wage, never mind the £12 per hour that we are committed to. So I'll take no lessons from the Scottish Tories on how we should have a system of childcare in this country. But we will, of course, continue to work with stakeholders to make sure that we will do what we can to deal with any concerns that they have and to build the best possible childcare system in Scotland that we can. Now, recognising the cost of living is still far too high for many families, we are already struggling with the increasingly unaffordable cost of food, housing, bills and everyday essentials, of course, as well as Brexit and the economic mismanagement by UK government. That is why both last year and this we have allocated almost £3 billion to support policies which tackle poverty and protect people as far as possible during the ongoing cost of living crisis. Beyond investment in our Scottish child payment, this includes continued provision of free bus travel for over 2 million people, including all young people under the age of 22. The tripling of our fuel insecurity fund to £30 million this year, and continuing to provide one of the most generous free school meal offers anywhere in the UK, saving parents £400 per eligible child per year. Now, we will continue to do everything we can within the scope of our powers and limited budget to tackle poverty and support those in greatest need, strengthening the support where we can. In 2023-24, we'll invest £5.3 billion in Scottish Government benefits, supporting over 1.2 million people, as well as extending further support we provide to carers by introducing the carers' support payment. We will invest £752 million this year through our Affordable Housing Supply Programme, and we will continue the Housing Bill to create powers for the introduction of long-term rent controls, creating new tenants' rights and introducing new duties aimed at the prevention of homelessness. We'll introduce a landmark human rights bill and invite the Scottish Parliament to bring back the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child and Corporation Scotland Bill for reconsideration stage to deliver legislation that protects and enhances a fuller range of human rights within the limits of devolved competence. And we will, of course, ensure that we consult with the intention of bringing a bill to Parliament on the end of conversion practices in Scotland. We will publish the Fair Fares Review both on the cost and availability of bus, rail and ferry services by the end of 2023 and introduce a pilot for the removal of ScotRail peak time fares beginning in October, in a move that will make rail travel more affordable and accessible during that pilot. So in closing, Presiding Officer, this year's programme for government builds on the foundations which we already have in Scotland, strengthening our approach to tackling poverty and inequality, providing equitable access to health and social care services and to treatment. We will continue to be frank about the need to make difficult decisions to ensure we free up resources to target support, and we will always continue to stand up for the people of Scotland against a UK government and any incoming Labour government with pay limitation Tory policies that hit the poorest hardest at their time of need. That is not what the people of Scotland need at this time or in any other. So as a government, we will use the powers that we have to address the root causes of poverty, but it is only with the full economic and fiscal powers of an independent nation that we can eradicate inequality and poverty in Scotland.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Megan Gallagher to speak to and to move Amendment 10343.2. Up to 9 minutes, please, Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the Scottish Conservative Amendment in my name. I welcome the opportunity to debate equality and the programme for government, because yesterday's programme was nothing short of disappointing. Hamza Yousaf promised us that he would be his own man and set out his own plan. Yet there is not a single word in this programme that could not have come from his predecessor. And I think it is quite telling that Nicola Sturgeon is taking part in this debate today to defend her prodigy's plan, because she pretty much wrote every policy in this document. And that is why this programme is so disappointing. When Scotland needed a bold, new, ambitious plan to tackle the big challenges faced by our economy and public services, the best Hamza Yousaf could do was copy Nicola Sturgeon's homework and continue her SNP failures. Now, before I continue with highlighting its problems, I do want to mention two areas of consensus in the programme that the Scottish Conservatives have outlined in our amendment. On support for families affected by miscarriage, the First Minister will always have my support when trying to support those who have suffered a terrible loss, and I commend him for speaking so openly about his own personal experience. I do hope that this gives those who have suffered a miscarriage strength, and I look forward to seeing more detail in the coming months. And on childcare. As a new mum, I know how quickly childcare costs can rise, not only for the childcare aspect, but for other financial pressures that go along with raising a child. I am pleased that the Scottish Government has finally listened to the Scottish Conservatives' calls to be bold and ambitious when it comes to the rollout of free childcare. Empowering parents is something I've been calling for quite some time. Simplifying the process for parents and giving them more choice over their child's care is the right course of action. And this doesn't take away from the crisis that is currently engulfing the sector. And while I will always welcome increased pay for carers, judging by the reaction on social media last night, the £12 an hour staff wage went down like a sinking ship. The government still doesn't get it. They don't understand the needs of the third private and voluntary organisations. It's not staff wages that is the problem. It's that local authorities set the rates per child for both themselves and effectively their competition. I've asked this before, how can a government organisation be a competitor and a banker at the same time? So I'll make this plea again. Fix the funding formula to create equality for the PVI sector. They are Scotland's first educators and the government must do more to support them. Presiding officer, now turning to the problems with the programme. This plan takes a lot of action to tackle violence against women and girls, and of course that action is welcome. But this is completely undermined by the fact that this government is continuing to push forward with its gender reform bill. This programme was a chance for the government to admit that they got this wrong and to drop the bill. Yet instead, they are charging ahead with a costly legal battle to take forward a law that the vast majority of Scots oppose. And they oppose it because everyone can see the massive loopholes that allow predatory men to take advantage of the system. Last year, the SNP government said that this would never happen. Yet mere weeks after the bill was passed, we had the case of Isla Bryson, the double rapist, who was initially remanded to a women's jail after being found guilty. We were told this wouldn't happen. If the SNP truly want to stand up for the rights and protections of women and girls, then they need to ditch the Gender Reform Bill. One area the government could focus on is the misinformation about contraception on social media that could be contributing to the high abortion figures. These are basic public health issues that the government could be focusing on. Then we have the message of building better communities. I learned quickly during my time as a councillor that the SNP rips the heart out of communities by ruthlessly cutting council budgets year on year. In North Lanarkshire alone, they will need to find £67 million worth of cuts over the next 3 years, on top of £228 million of cuts over the last decade. Yes, I will.
Deputy First Minister.
I'm not sure if the member has paid any attention to what is happening in England with council after council going bankrupt.
Yep.
Tory councils, Labour councils. Will she not take any responsibility for the lack of funding and financial mismanagement of local government by her government in England? Surely. What a brass neck you have.
Megan Gallagher.
I'm not quite sure the Cabinet Secretary understands the damage her government is doing to local authorities across Scotland. Community centres, vital services and swimming pools, which if the Cabinet Secretary would like to stay behind for the debate that's taking after this debate this evening, you could maybe see the damage that's been inflicted by her government at that point in time. I've also learned during my short time as an MSP that to have stronger communities, you need to have better infrastructure. But as we've all seen during the SNP's time in government, we've got fewer GP surgeries and appointments available, our high streets and town centres are about to collapse, and no real investment for our rural communities. And while I'm on the point of infrastructure, what about the A9 or the A96? This announcement from Hamza Yousaf fell flat yesterday, all because he committed to dualling the roads, then he couldn't tell us when the road would be completed. And I'm not a betting woman, presiding officer, but I do bet you anything, if the Greens were not in government, that road would be further along than what it is just now. The Greens are anti-growth and anti-roads. Finally, tackling child poverty. The SNP promised to deliver free school meals by August 2022. Now they've announced that they'll work with COSLA to expand free school meal provision to primary 6 and primary 7. And this doesn't even include breakfast, which we know is proven to set up kids for the day and to improve their learning and their behaviours in the classroom. Is this government incompetent or incapable? Either way, they are trying to hoodwink the public into thinking that they are delivering for Scotland, when in fact they are not. Presiding officer, the SNP will spend this debate praising their record on equality and saying that this programme will continue those achievements. A session of ritual backpatting and Nicola Sturgeon defending her legacy. But beyond the spin, the poorest people in Scotland are being failed by this government. Drug deaths remain the highest in Europe, alcohol deaths are the highest since 2008, and homelessness has reached an all-time high, with children being placed in temporary accommodation. All the while, women and girls are being failed by this government, hell-bent on introducing a gender recognition reform bill and by not having the correct public health messaging around contraception. Those are the facts that the SNP want to ignore, but that is the reality that they are being faced with by the people across Scotland. Presiding officer, this programme was a chance to tackle those big challenges, but instead we have the same reheated promises from a government that has quite clearly run out of ideas. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. I now call on Paul O'Kane to speak to and to move Amendment 10343.1. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And in opening this debate for Scottish Labour, I move the amendment in my name. I'm pleased to have the opportunity to open this debate on equalities in the programme for government, and I will begin with areas of consensus. As Anna Sarwar outlined in yesterday's debate, there are areas within the programme which Scottish Labour support. We have long called for improvements in the pay of social care workers, so finally seeing some progress on this area is to be welcomed, despite being told repeatedly by the government, including the First Minister when he was Health Secretary, that it couldn't be done. We've also long supported efforts to improve access to childcare across Scotland, because we know that access to good, high-quality, truly flexible childcare can reduce poverty and support people, especially women, into the workplace. I'll give way to the
First Minister.
Just to go back to the issue of the social care workforce, I notice in your amendment you talk about a workable plan for achieving £15 an hour minimum wage for hard-working social care workers. Now, given that Labour have set themselves against any tax increase, whether it's income tax or council tax, could Paul O'Kane explain to us what Labour's workable plan is to get to £15 an hour for social care workers?
Paul O'Kane.
The Deputy First Minister well knows that budget after budget, the Scottish Labour Party have brought proposals to this chamber on how we can accelerate to £12 an hour and to £13 an hour. The former Finance Secretary said it couldn't be done, said £12 an hour couldn't be done, and consistently refused to engage on those points. Presiding Officer, we have long supported efforts to improve childcare. Of course, we support the actions outlined to move forward the work of Baroness Kennedy's review on misogyny law and support women and families who have experienced baby loss across Scotland. And I think we've heard very powerful contributions across the chamber on that regard. But let's be honest, Presiding Officer. This relaunch of Hamza Yousaf's government, already tired just after 6 months, is underwhelming. Just 24 hours after the statement, it's been met with a lukewarm response at best from anti-poverty organisations, the third sector and wider Civic Scotland. It's been described as a timid step in addressing injustice by Save the Children. The Poverty Alliance said it missed a crucial opportunity to turn our shared values of justice and compassion into meaningful action, and it fails to meet the challenges described by Shelter Scotland. Because the challenges before us are great. We face twin crises, the cost of living and an NHS on its knees. The response to these crises must match the scale of the challenge. Continuity won't cut it, as someone famously said, but continuity from this First Minister is exactly what we got. And the reality doesn't match the rhetoric. Instead of direct action and new interventions, we have a document that's full of pilots, proposals, exploratory work and steering groups, and many of those initiatives are just re-announcements. The government's flagship policy of removing income thresholds for Best Start payments is a re-announcement of existing policy and does little for those in the deepest poverty. No new spending has been announced on the child payment. The SNP government is expecting credit for maintaining the status quo. And on the annual recycled pledge of free school meals, this is now delayed until 2026, and beginning with that limited rollout. How many times will the government promise and then not deliver. It is clear, Presiding Officer, that this is a tired continuity government lacking direction. The reality is the SNP government is failing, and it is out of ideas on how to turn the situations around in Scotland. And there are clarion calls in a moment. There are clarion calls around Scotland that the government are going to fail to meet their own statutory poverty targets. I'll give way.
Minister Emma Roddick.
I just wonder, given this government's anti-poverty measures so far have estimated to have lifted 90,000 children out of poverty, is that not the sort of thing that we should be continuing with?
Paul O'Kane.
As I have just said, the government is on track to miss the legally binding poverty targets that have been set. And there are clarion calls across Scotland pointing out that they are going to miss those targets. Now, I need to make progress. None more so than the Fraser of Allender Institute, who said, missing a statutory target should be a big deal, shouldn't it? Instead, we have the equivalent of a shrug and a suggestion that the constitutional settlement means that we lack the necessary levers. And we've already heard plenty about the constitutional settlement already in this debate about poverty today. Because we can and we must do more. Scottish Labour have offered interventions to tackle the cost of living crisis and prevent people experiencing poverty that have been ignored by this government. Capping the cost of public transport, rebate on water bills, mortgage rescue schemes and taking that quicker action on paying care workers, not £12 an hour but £15 an hour. And if the First Minister and the Cabinet are serious, if the Deputy First Minister is serious about their offer to listen and work work on this, then they must engage with our proposals. And I spoke of care workers, Presiding Officer, because we know how vital health and social care is to ensuring the best life for everyone in Scotland. But it does seem that health and social care are at best an afterthought in this programme for government, and at worst something the government doesn't actively want to talk about. It took the First Minister 22 minutes to mention the NHS in his speech yesterday, and it's more of the same in today's motion from the government, just one single sentence about health and social care. Over 820,000 people are languishing on waiting lists, whilst over 7,000 NHS vacancies remain unfilled. A crisis in our health service being felt every single day by people up and down Scotland, that is the reality under the SNP. Hard-working staff are crying out for action. So where are the big, bold solutions to help alleviate that pressure? Where is a renewed recovery and catch-up plan? Where is a meaningful workforce plan? Where is the action to properly fix social care to ensure that people can get out of hospital and live good and well-supported lives in their communities? Of course, we recognise the reopening of the Independent Living Fund, something that we have been calling on government to do as successive programmes for government and budgets. And I know as convener of the cross-party group on learning disability that this will be welcomed, but we would want to see it move faster and further than the phased approach and become more sustainable. I would ask, however, Presiding Officer, where is the further action in social care? The government pledged its 2021 manifesto to abolish non-residential care charges. We have time and again called on the government to honour this commitment to disabled people and their families.
The member should be concluding.
But each year it slips further and further into the parliamentary calendar for delivery. Today, along with my colleagues, I met with campaigners outside Parliament on this issue. Rhys, Sandy and Kerry were just some of the people who spoke to me about the huge difference that these changes would make, removing these charges would make for their lives, their well-being and their mental health. And they told me how disappointed they were not to see this in the programme for government. So I do urge the government to once again look at how we do this quickly, and we will work constructively with the government as campaigners want us all to do to deliver this. Presiding Officer, it is clear that this programme for government was billed as a reset moment for Hamza Yousaf and a tired 16-year SNP government. Instead of hitting the reset button, it's rewind on some announcements and pause on others. I think the reality is that the people of Scotland are looking not for reset or rewind, but for change. And we on these benches are ready to rise to that challenge and deliver change. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Kane. I now call on Liam MacArthur. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I am pleased to have the chance to briefly contribute to this afternoon's debate on the programme for government. The title, Equality, Opportunity, Community, throws up issues I want to reflect on further specifically from an island perspective. But let me start by saying that there is much in the programme and in today's motion that Scottish Liberal Democrats warmly welcome, indeed quite a few aspects that we have been calling for. I might gently point out that there are a few initiatives, heat in buildings, free school meals and fair fares review, that could charitably be described as frequent flyers in programme for government statements. But in the spirit of consensus, let me declare an obvious interest in these initiatives and confirm my willingness to work with ministers in the hope that they can deliver in these areas for communities like Orkney, where there is a particularly acute need. Of course, the centrepiece of the First Minister's statement yesterday, and featured again prominently in today's motion, is the commitment to further expand childcare provision. And this is certainly welcome. It's had a welcome around the Chamber. And a good example of an issue where Scottish Liberal Democrats have been pressing successive SNP governments to be more ambitious. My colleague Willie Rennie frequently raised it with Alex Salmond when he was First Minister and before he was airbrushed out of SNP history. Indeed, I remember Willie Rennie and the Chamber repeatedly being told that expanding childcare to 1140 hours could only be done with the powers of independence. I was a member of the Education Committee at the time, and it was an assertion regularly repeated to us by the Cabinet Secretary then, Aileen Campbell. It was nonsense, of course, and when Mr Salmond realised it just made him look like the needs of Scottish children and their parents were being held hostage in the interests of the SNP, he relented and brought forward an amendment to the Children and Young People's Bill. What that experience also showed, however, is that it's not just the quantum of early learning and childcare offered. Quality, flexibility and availability matter every bit as much, if not more. We know, for example, that as funding for childcare has increased, availability has often contracted. More than 300 private and voluntary childcare services have stopped operating since 2021. There's been a 47% fall in nursery teacher numbers over the last decade. Half of private nurseries say their businesses are unsustainable, and a third of childminders have quit since 2016, a figure the Scottish Childminding Association expects will double by 2026. Very briefly.
Martin Whitfield.
MacArthur to give way. And on that point, isn't it also a truism that the families who have suffered the most at trying to gain access to child benefit are some of the poorest families in Scotland?
Liam MacArthur.
I think that's a point very well made by Martin Whitfield. Even if the government succeeds in growing the workforce by 1,000, it still won't reach the level it was at in 2019. This lack of availability and choice poses problems everywhere for those most in need, but it poses particular issues in rural and island areas. The number of childminders in Orkney has plummeted by 40% over the past decade. I know from my own mailbag the real impact this is having on my constituents, not least on women looking to return to or remain in employment. On that theme of equality and opportunity in rural and island areas, let me conclude with a few areas where the government urgently needs to up its game in the interests of fairness, equality, opportunity and community resilience. Funding for local councils has been squeezed across the board, but Orkney Islands Council continues to suffer from lower funding per head of population than other island authorities. Now more than ever, this is resulting in cuts to services upon which some of the most vulnerable in my constituency rely. We need to see a more equitable settlement across our islands. On transport, the First Minister promised new ferries, albeit ones already in construction. To date, though, this is an excluded replacement of Orkney's ageing internal fleet, despite the fact that it is as crucial to providing a lifeline to islands in my constituency as Calmac's fleet is to islands on the west coast. The task force set up to look at this issue needs to deliver and map out urgently a funded programme for ferry replacement. On RET2, this SNP government has failed to deliver cheaper ferries fares on Pentland Firth routes to match those in place for a decade and more on the west coast. SNP ministers blame UK state aid rules, having previously blamed EU state aid rules, but have confirmed they've made no effort to agree a way forward with the UK government. And the failure of this government to deliver its promise to superfast broadband to 100% of premises by 2021 means the digital divide between the haves and the have-nots remains as wide as ever. Orkney has the poorest coverage and lowest speeds anywhere in the country. This affects access to services, education, business opportunities and much more. The digital divide undermines whatever aspirations this government may have in terms of equality, opportunity and building resilient communities. Presiding Officer, there are many more examples I could cite that illustrate the mismatch between promises made by SNP ministers and the daily reality for islanders. The programme for government repeats some of those promises and adds quite a few more. Making such promises is easy. What islanders and people across Scotland want to see, though, is a commitment to painstaking delivery. That will be the real test of what the First Minister set out yesterday.
Thank you, Mr. MacArthur. We now move to the open debate. I would remind members that the speeches are of up to 6 minutes. I call Cocab Stewart to be followed by Liam Kerr. Ms. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I focus on just some of the equality measures set out in the programme for government, I would like to put on record how pleased I was yesterday to hear about the commitment to bring forward legislation to tackle dangerous cladding in residential buildings, an issue that I've been working on very closely with the hundreds of residents in my constituency and have met with the Housing Minister a number of times, even raised it during First Minister's questions. And this commitment is the hallmark of a government that has engaged and responded. If Scots were ever in any doubt of the massive gap in priorities between this government sitting in Edinburgh and that in London, yesterday's programme for government demonstrated it very clearly. A Tory UK government guilty of negligence, responsible for economic disaster, the incompetence and uncaring architects of the cost of living crisis. All the while, a Labour so-called opposition that sits back and supports the status quo. Meantime, here in Scotland, we have a First Minister and a Scottish Government with an agenda for change that will empower women, lift children out of poverty and protect our minority groups while promoting growth. Now, let's be clear, no community can reach its full potential unless all its constituent parts have the equal opportunity to contribute. And yesterday's programme for government and the new Human Rights Bill shows the true understanding of that, which I look forward to scrutinising with colleagues as it progresses through this place. The Scottish Government's record on LGBT plus equality can be measured on the streets. In July, I joined thousands of marchers going through Glasgow City Centre for Mardi Gras. This is a minority group who feel supported by a government in perhaps ways that they didn't in 15 or 20 years ago. In response to an Equality, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee report on banning LGBT plus conversion therapy practices, the Scottish Government said in March 2022 it is committed to, and I quote, bringing forward legislation as far as is practical within the powers available to it by the end of 2023. And I welcome the update from the Cabinet Secretary on the timescales. And I do ask that this would be done in a sensitive way so as to avoid re-traumatising the people that we have to listen to. Presiding Officer, I'm encouraged that such a significant proportion of the Scottish Government's priorities focus heavily on building a society where women are safer and can better contribute. And that includes supporting the work of Gillian Mackay to introduce safe buffer zones and the legislation being brought forward on misogyny. I would, however, welcome any update from the Cabinet Secretary that she may have on the progress of the Public Sector Equality Duty Review, as ensuring equal treatment, protection and opportunity within our public services is the gold standard that we all have a right to expect. I, along with many colleagues, welcome the expansion in childcare that will also be a significant boost for women and their households. In the last Parliament, this place passed its ratification of the UNCRC, and I'm encouraged that the Scottish Government is working with the Supreme Court ruling on this and will welcome an update as to when we can expect the Bill's amended return. We must, of course, recognise, and colleagues have, the significance of the Scottish Child Payment is to families with lower incomes, a benefit that doesn't exist elsewhere in the UK. I met with the Child Poverty Action Group over the summer recess, and having called the introduction of the Scottish Child Payment a game changer, I'm pleased that the First Minister yesterday committed to assessing how much further this benefit can go in supporting children from lower income households. But there are, of course, clear restraints on spending ability of this Parliament, and sadly, it does come down to the money. So let us not forget, however, that while the Scottish Government gives with one hand, on the other hand is the Tory Government that takes away with cruel policies such as the two-child limit on benefits and the rate clause. A policy that penalises 1 in 10 children. A policy that costs families an estimated £3,235 per year. And a policy that is shamefully supported by Keir Starmer and the Labour Party. Yet again, Labour offers no alternative to the Tories, and I note that the Scottish Labour leader still has not responded to my letter to him, calling on him to reconsider his position on reversing the two-child cap and rate clause, which he considers not to be a priority. Labour might want to stand by why folk all over the country struggle, that's their prerogative, but the people of Scotland can see that the alternative is here. The people of Scotland can see that as far as possible, this government, a devolved government, has announced a programme for government that will be a game changer, that will continue to lift more and more people out of poverty and increase their opportunities. It's a positive blueprint for change, a vote of confidence in the potential of a country and its people. And I welcome that programme for government.
Thank you, Ms. Stewart. I would advise members at this point there is some time in hand and therefore time for intervention, should members wish to take interventions. I now call Liam Kerr to be followed by Nicola Sturgeon. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I found that interesting that Cockup Stewart majored on priorities, because I listened carefully to the First Minister's speech yesterday, one in which he committed explicitly to reduce poverty. I listened to what he said, and I listened to what he didn't. Yeah. And I've read the government motion today, which is titled Equality Within the 2023 to 24 Programme for Government. And what concerns me is that if we start from a position that education is a priority and key to understanding, then addressing poverty and inequalities, it is staggering that there were so few mentions of schools. Mm-hmm. And what worries me even more is that I believe the Cabinet Secretary for Education, in a second, Mr. Stewart, Cabinet Secretary for Education also cares deeply about this. And it would be deeply irresponsible for the First Minister to sideline this portfolio and his Cabinet Secretary, relegating education from the number one priority to something far from it. And in fact, a great example of that, yes, Mr. Stewart.
Kevin Stewart.
I agree that education is a priority, but having talked to many teachers over the years in my own constituency, one of the things which they say to me, it is very difficult to teach a child in the morning with a hungry belly. This government has made a difference in terms of free school meal provision. It is something that the Tories should consider, that poor children often go to school hungry. That means they're unable to learn because of Tory austerity.
Liam Kerr.
I actually think that for part of that, Mr. Stewart makes an important point. And the Magic Breakfast, of course, as Mr. Stewart will know, say that Scotland's actually an outlier when it comes to having no nationally funded breakfast provision. Yep. And of course, if we're going to talk about food in schools, Mr. Stewart, a great example of the Scottish Government taking its eye off the ball is the 2021 programme for government, in which the SNP promised to provide free school meals to all primary schools, yep, by August 2022, yep, which was something the First Minister seemed to forget, incidentally, on the radio this morning. Well, yesterday, the First Minister confirmed the words on page 40 of the programme for government that this won't be universal until 2026, four years yep, later than promised. And that despite acknowledging the point that Kevin Stewart makes, that yesterday's programme said the highest standards of nutrition are vital to our children's effective learning, yep, which is why the 2021-22 programme's commitment to deliver free breakfasts to all primary and special school children and start to provide to pilot provision, which was not mentioned at all in yesterday's programme for government. I'll carry on and see if I have time, Deputy First Minister. It is exactly that sort of smoke and mirrors that the First Minister is employing that we have to get away from. So, for example, I notice at page 36 of the programme for government, we have seen good progress in closing the poverty-related attainment gap since the pandemic. But in fact, according to the 2023 SQA monitoring report, the attainment gap has widened for the third year in a row at both National 5 and higher level. And worse, the actual attainment per se, despite the best efforts of our teachers, staff and pupils themselves, has dropped, with SQA attainment statistics showing the A to C pass rate in National 5, higher and advanced higher, all lower than in 2022. Yes, go ahead.
Cabinet Secretary.
Grateful to the member for that. Can he also welcome the fact that we have record positive destinations for our young people? And while he's at it, will he join with me and the First Minister in encouraging the Prime Minister to support the Essentials Guarantee if he's genuinely interested in putting food into the stomachs of bairns? Support us to ensure that the welfare state actually allows that where it's still mostly reserved.
Liam Kerr.
Of course I welcome positive destinations, but the Cabinet Secretary has conveniently failed to remember that when we talk about destinations post-school, there have been 140,000 fewer college places since the SNP came to power, and our UCAS data is showing that there's been a year-on-year reduction in people going, and that has to be taken into account. And I just want to pick up the point that I made before the intervention, because I said this is despite the best efforts of our teachers, staff and pupils. And I do not for one minute lay this at the door of our schools, or the staff, or the students themselves. I lay it entirely at the door of a government which promised to recruit 3,500 additional teachers last year, but has overseen numbers fall by 92. It runs a teacher qualification scheme, which sees the proportion of post-probationers teaching the year following their probation at its lowest since 2016. It leaves at least 5,000 of our teachers on temporary contracts, has presided over what the Daily Record calls an epidemic of youth violence. And as we learned yesterday from the school estate statistics, presides over a situation in which 60,000 pupils are being taught in schools in a poor or bad condition.
The member will be concluding.
Presiding
shortly.
Officer, there are many warm words in this programme for government, but precious few for education, which is a pity, because as I said, I respect the Cabinet Secretary on this, and I know she shares my desire to get it sorted. It's why I hope she will be receptive to our policies to ensure funding follows the child, that gives head teachers more power over their schools, which empowers teachers through a new deal for teachers. Now, I look forward to working with her on that, and part of that is to ensure that education is always on the agenda in motions which forget it, such as this one. And that's why I ensured it was in the amendment in the name of Megan Gallagher today, and that's why I asked the Chamber to support that amendment.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call on Nicola Sturgeon to be followed by Karen Maughan. Ms Sturgeon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is my first speech here solely as the MSP for Glasgow South Side. And it's also the first programme for government in 17 years that I've not been involved in as either First Minister or Deputy First Minister. So to say that my perspective on politics has altered would be something of an understatement. Certain things look different, perhaps a bit clearer, in fact, from here than from the trenches of the political front line, and I'll perhaps return to that later. Firstly, though, straight to yesterday's programme for government. I enthusiastically commend it. I can't claim to be entirely objective, but in my view, it does strike the right balance between building on progress and breaking new ground.
Much has been said, of course, about the importance of the economy. Rightly, there can be no strong society without a strong, sustainable economy. However, the opposite, while just as true, has traditionally had less attention. It has been right, therefore, in my view, to address this, and I commend the First Minister for keeping the mission for a fairer society where everyone can contribute to and benefit from the fruits of the economy very firmly in vision. The economy will not, never will, flourish when systemic barriers prevent people accessing the labour market, especially when lack of population growth is one of the most significant challenges we face, or when poverty robs too many people of opportunity and fulfilment. I am extremely proud of the doubling of early years education and childcare, a vitally important infrastructure project as well as social initiative, and I'm proud too of the establishment of the Scottish Child Payment. These deliver immediate benefits, especially to the 90,000 children being lifted out of poverty right now. But the real value of these, of course, will be long term. In that vein, I very much welcome plans to further expand childcare. The pilot that was announced yesterday is a sensible approach, and I hope very much that it will lead as soon as possible to mainstreamed provision. I also want to take the opportunity today to mention the promise to our care experience young people, a mission that is and always will be very close to my heart. Yes.
Ross McCall.
I thank the member for the intervention. The member will be aware of the Promise Oversight Board. They had a report that came out in June of this year, where the board states that it doesn't believe that delivering the aims of the plan 21-24 is realistic by next year. Does the minister agree with the Oversight Board's assessment?
Nicola Sturgeon.
I do believe that that is the case right now, but I don't believe that that is inevitably what has to be, which brings me exactly to the point I wanted to make. The promise is, and it always will be, a mission very close to my heart, and this is very relevant to the point the member raises. As on so many areas, there is a need to make up for time lost to the pandemic, and that is why I do welcome and applaud the focus that a new cabinet subcommittee will bring. The promise is, of course, about improving the lives of young people in care, but we must also remember that it's about something else as well, supporting families better so that fewer young people need to go into care in the first place. And to that end, I look forward to hearing about progress in financing and implementing the critically important Whole Family Wellbeing Fund. The other aspect of the programme for government that merits, I'll take one more intervention.
Pam Duncan-Clancy.
I thank the member for taking that intervention, and I recognise the contribution of the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund, but will the member recognise then that 18 months into the pilot in Glasgow, not a penny has been commissioned yet, and there are organisations like the Govan Help who are critical in delivering these services who really need some of that money?
Nicola Sturgeon.
Yes, I do. That's why I think progress does need to be accelerated, which is why I mentioned that point. The other aspect of the programme for government that merits close attention is access action to accelerate the green transition, essential to safeguarding the planet and building a fairer society, but also the most important opportunity we have to achieve sustainable economic growth. I welcome plans to take forward the recommendations from the FM Investor Panel established towards the end of my time in office. Moving away from fossil fuels, which we must do, doesn't mean turning off the North Sea taps overnight, as some mischaracterise, but turning on new taps, and the First Minister is right to criticise the UK Government approach, makes only a marginal, at best, difference to the lifespan of the North Sea, but comes at a heavy cost to the environment and also to the focus we need on building renewables capacity as quickly as possible. Lastly, on climate, I look forward to seeing Scotland's world-leading commitments on financing for the loss and damage suffered by the Global South taken forward fully. I want to conclude, Presiding Officer, with a few words, not so much on what we do here, but on how we do it. Before I do, let me say that I accept my share of responsibility for the state of our political discourse.
If anything, though, that makes me more determined to play a part in trying to change it. Polarisation in politics is much maligned. It is the paralysis of action that it can result in, though, that should worry us most. So perhaps we need to, as we embark on a new term, have some principles in mind to guide us. Firstly, a collective recognition that the challenges we face require tough decisions. These are by definition hard, they're often unpopular, and will always meet resistance from those who benefit from the status quo. That's not an argument to ignore those voices, but it is important that we make sure that they don't become an automatic veto on the change that is necessary. Second, an acceptance that we can't just wish for the ends of our policy objectives. We must also have the means to deliver. That means mature debate on how we pay for our policy priorities, but also on the powers this Parliament has and needs. I want this Parliament to be independent and believe it soon will be. I don't think I'm creating news with that statement. But that will never stop me arguing for incremental change along the way. And likewise, those who oppose independence shouldn't close their minds to new powers that allow us to better tackle the big challenges we face in the here and now. And finally, Presiding Officer, disagreement and robust debate isn't just the essence of democracy. It's part of what makes us human. But the dynamic that it creates is not fixed.
First Minister, you will need to conclude. Sorry, Nicola Sturgeon, you will need to conclude.
Will it be acrimony and stalemate, or can we use the creative tension to drive improvement for all? I hope that in this term we see more of the latter than the former, and I look forward to playing my part in it.
Thank you, Ms Sturgeon. I now call, and I would advise members, there is a bit of time in hand, so I can be generous in circumstances where interventions have been taken. I call Cara Mochan to be followed by Kevin Stewart. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst I note the Cabinet Secretary and Government's commitments on child poverty, health and social justice, I hope I will be forgiven for pointing out that it is all very vague. Unfortunately, however, I think we can all agree vague is pretty much what we have come to expect from this government. And I look to the backbenches and comment that not only do they expect it, they do accept it. After 16 years of varying incompetence and financial mismanagement, we are left with another programme for government which does not amount to much more than carrying on and papering over the cracks. A programme for government that suggests this administration has run out of ideas and run out of road. Indeed, a programme for government described by key stakeholders as timid. Scots are being told of council tax and income tax rises to come, and the top line in this programme for government is one pushed for by Scottish Labour relentlessly, the £12 for carers. But £12 for carers, that is 7 months away, and it's over a year since Hamza Yousaf first made that promise. We need it now, and we need a route for £15 an hour. Another new flagship, we've had discussion on that point already, thank you. Another new flagship policy announced with that of removing... Another new flagship policy announced was that of removing income thresholds for the Best Start payments. Only it is not a new policy at all. They are simply announcing again an already existing policy commitment. And I think that we can do a lot better than that. Health inequalities in Scotland are growing. We are 2 years into so-called NHS recovery plan, and it would be fair to say things are not going well. 820,000 on waiting lists, over 7,000 NHS vacancies remain unfilled, and getting a dentist appointment is becoming increasingly difficult, borderline impossible in a constituency such as mine, south of Scotland. By definition, a recovery plan should see things improve, no matter how slowly. But under this SNP government, things continue to get worse, and this programme for government highlights the fading ambition of a tired party of government. Getting these things right are the basic building blocks of a successfully run health service, but ours is crumbling beneath our feet despite the best efforts of staff who are overworked and underpaid. In public health, we are simply not moving with enough purpose. Review after review of policies the government have considered enacting for years, a strategy with no real intention of delivery. No real intention of delivery. Yet just recently we learned that alcohol-specific deaths have increased to the highest levels in years,
with an increase in the number of women tragically dying. This situation will not improve by tinkering around the edges and moving slowly. We need real and lasting action, and we need it now. And this programme for government falls very short of delivering on that. Delivering anything after 16 years, delivery, it seems, is not this government's intention. Indeed, Presiding Officer, the same issues with announcing strategies but lack of delivery exist in women's health. Not even a mention for the Women's Health Plan in yesterday's speech to Parliament by the First Minister. And I have to say I'm not surprised. Health inequalities impacting women in our most deprived areas remain deep and divisive. Staff safing legislation that would support women working in healthcare settings still not delivered, and reports of community midwifery and screening services becoming harder to access in the areas where they are needed most. Our communities won't change, but this continuity First Minister, continuity government is just offering more of the same. And the reality is more of the same means suffering for the vulnerable in our population. Presiding Officer, we know that social care was put under incredible strain by COVID, and yet after working their fingers to the bone, the country moving carers, working their fingers to the bone to keep the country moving, carers still cannot see a route to getting £15 an hour from this government. They will rightly wonder if they will ever receive a decent wage from this SNP and Green government. I think they are justified in concluding that their work is not valued enough by this government. And I look to the Green benches. They have promised this section of our workforce a lot. There is an alternative. The next UK Labour government will fundamentally reform universal credit so that there is a proper safety net for those who are struggling. I'm going to continue, thank you. Those who are struggling to find work. And within the first 100 days of that government, we will deliver a new deal for working people, banning zero-hour contracts, extending sick pay, and making sure the minimum wage is a wage that people can actually live on. When Labour was last
Ms. Malkin, sorry to interrupt. Could you please resume your seat just for one wee second? Could we have less chit-chat across the front benches, please, because it's disrespectful to Ms. Malkin, who is trying to make her contribution. Please continue, Ms. Malkin.
The measures that I mentioned will have a direct impact on inequality and give families the ability to make choices that can help them build for the future without having to constantly worry about where they can find where ends meet. This is what Labour will deliver. I was just about to come. I will take the intervention.
Cabinet Secretary, briefly, please.
Very grateful for the member for taking an intervention. Given that Keir Starmer has said that he and Anna Sarwar are welded together on key issues and you promote change in the Labour Party, can the member perhaps explain how Keir Starmer intends to make the rape clause be implemented more fairly? What does that actually mean?
Cara Mochan.
Thank you. I wish that this government would want to talk about their own programme for government. I have set out exactly why. I'm going to make
the member
progress.
Is trying to conclude her remarks.
I'm going to make progress. I have set out some of the things that the Labour government in Westminster have said that they will do. And I think the point that should be made to the front bench here of the SNP government is that Labour will deliver. We have a history of delivering. When Labour was last in power across the UK, we lifted 2 million children out of poverty, 200,000 of which were in Scotland. There are now 40,000 more children living in poverty in Scotland than a decade ago. That's the SNP legacy, and it won't be erased by such underwhelming reform. In the here and now, we have to recognise that Scots have suffered through serious financial and health concerns due to the cost of living crisis, growing NHS crisis. These same people will be expecting a bit more from the first programme for government from this First Minister. I imagine many of them will be left very disappointed, and I hope that the SNP benches will consider those points. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Sandesh Gohani. Mr Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And during these challenging times as we emerge from the COVID-19 pandemic, deal with the horrors of Brexit and the brutality of 13 years of Westminster austerity, now people have to face the Tory-made cost of living crisis. And now, more than ever, the people of Scotland need a Scottish Government that is on their side. And that's why I'm pleased that the focus of the programme for government is on reducing poverty, creating sustainable growth and on providing quality public services. I welcome the ambition to increase childcare provision to make it even fairer and more affordable for those that need it most. I welcome the decision to raise the pay of childcare staff and of social care workers who tirelessly work to support the most vulnerable in our society. And I welcome the fact that we will continue to build a social security system here that is built on dignity, fairness and respect. At the end of last year, FT Analysis called the UK a poor society with some very rich people. We have an enormous wealth gap, which is ever increasing across the UK. And yet, most other countries in Europe, countries that are comparable to Scotland, are wealthier and fairer. They, of course, are independent. And that's why I want to see an independent Scotland, as I believe that we could do so much better. Within the powers that we have spent over £700 million in the last 5 years mitigating Westminster welfare cuts. The Scottish Government has helped improve the lives of over 316,000 children with the introduction of the game-changing Scottish Child Payment. And of course, we have delivered more affordable housing per head of population than anywhere else in the UK. But we could do so much more as an independent nation with all of the levers of power. And talking of independence, I can hardly advocate for freedom and independence for a country without thinking of the freedom and independence for our people, all of our people. Disabled people have been hit badly during the course of the pandemic, by Brexit and by the cost of living crisis. Many feel that they have not been served well by public services and they have not had the support that they require. I am therefore very happy to see a commitment by the First Minister to reopen the Independent Living Fund to allow more disabled people to control their own care and lives and to give them the freedom and independence that is enjoyed by those who currently access the ILF. And I'll give way to Ms Bailey.
Jackie Bailey.
And it is on the point of the ILF because my recollection is that the SNP promised to open up the ILF fund some 16 years ago. What's taken you so long?
Chemistry.
Well, I think that what has taken us so long, and Jackie Bailey supports it, is Westminster rule and Tory austerity over the past 13 years. And those folks who had advocated for the reopening of the ILF recognise that the Scottish Government has had its budgets cut over the piece by Westminster Government. Can I say, Presiding Officer, it's also gratifying to see that there is a commitment in the PFG to review the adult disability payment so that it meets the needs of disabled people in full. There's a pledge to increase our social security payments in line with inflation. And the ambition to replace carer's allowance with a carer support payment to improve support for unpaid carers. All good news, but think how much more we could do with the full powers of independence and no Tory Westminster austerity. We also need to do more to ensure that neurodiverse people, autistic folk, and those with a learning disability can lead independent lives too, and access services, jobs and housing. And I'm glad to see that the government intends to consult on the proposed Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill this year. I know that Minister Marie Todd has a fantastic team of people behind her to drive this work and a fabulous set of engaged stakeholders too. But moving to improving the lives of people does not necessarily require new legislation. We should look to the good that is going on now. We Too, an organisation in Aberdeen, has teamed up with Cadonas Amusements to hold a disabled-friendly night, with hopefully many more to come. I know that these kind of partnerships are growing across the country, but we should all be encouraging more collaborations and fostering a greater understanding of and meeting the needs of neurodiverse people. Project SEARCH, a collaboration in Aberdeen between the University of Aberdeen, Values into Action Scotland and public sector partners, has been on the go for a decade, providing apprenticeships for learning disabled people, which has successfully seen many, many folk getting jobs, having more fulfilling lives and gaining their independence. We should be doing more to encourage these kinds of projects throughout our country to bring new talent to our workforce. Equality, opportunity and community are the key goals in this programme for government. And it would be remiss of me not to say that in order to gain equality, to maintain opportunity and to retain cohesive communities in the North East, we must have a just transition that works and is supportive of the change that is required. We all recognise that we have to diversify, that we have to grow green jobs, and we should all understand that oil and gas still has a part to play as we move to net zero.
Mr Stewart, are you concluding your remarks?
Sorry?
Are you concluding, Mr Stewart?
I'm almost there, Presiding Officer. Thank you very much.
Excellent, because you're quite a busy
I welcome the Scottish Government's £500 million transition fund. I share the First Minister's ambition that Aberdeen should become the world's renewable energy capital, and I'm keen to support the First Minister and the Government to make this a reality, and I welcome this programme for
Government.
Thank you,
Mr Stewart. I now call Fergus Gohani to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Dr Gohani.
Thank you. I wish to declare my interests as a practising NHS GP. The SNP has been responsible for health in Scotland continuously since May the 17th, 2007, when Nicola Sturgeon, here today, though leaving, took office as Cabinet Secretary, running it for over 5 years. This was a time when she cut the number of nurses in training, and also a time when serious concerns were raised about a certain neurosurgeon, Dr. Sam El-Jamal, who also doubled as a government advisor. Incidentally, despite patients outside today protesting, there is no backing for a public inquiry. More than a third of patients are waiting over 4 hours to be seen in Scotland's emergency departments. And that situation is getting worse, not in the depths of winter, but here in high summer. And we know excessive waiting leads to unnecessary deaths. Over 820,000 patients are on waiting lists. We have an adult mental health crisis, a child and adolescent mental health crisis. We also have record high drug and alcohol related deaths because people can't get the treatment and support they badly need and want. Scotland's NHS and support services are spiralling out of control on the SNP's watch. And what happens when vital health services fail? Let me tell you, patients suffer, staff suffer, health inequalities soar. Across our communities most impacted by health inequalities, you'll find the highest rates of alcohol and drug dependence. Yet, there's been no cohesive strategy, little in the way of action to help families and communities from successive SNP governments. The families of 1,276 Scots who died last year to alcohol are grieving the loss of their loved one. Alcohol-related deaths continue to reign the highest since 2008. When you add drug-related deaths, the highest rate in Europe, over 2,300 people lost their lives to drug and alcohol in Scotland last year alone. And here's a shameful stat. People in the most deprived areas of Scotland are 15 times more likely to die from drug misuse than those in the least deprived areas. People in our poorer communities suffer the most because of the SNP's inability to get on top of their brief.
Minister Emma Roddick.
The member has drawn an important link there between health inequality and income inequality. So will he welcome the measures that we are bringing in to tackle poverty in these communities, which will, of course, reduce those health inequalities?
Dr. Gohani.
I would really like it if you were to be on top of your brief and actually do the things that we need you to do when it comes to healthcare, like I will go on to point out in the rest of my speech. With regard to alcohol, the SNP has tried one flagship approach: to make alcohol more expensive and so, frankly, deter the less well-off from purchasing. The trouble is, we know that people are going without food instead. The minimum unit pricing policy has now been discredited by none other than the SNP itself. They set to put a more convenient and positive spin on a Public Health Scotland report into MUP by shoehorning words like significant into the draft in order to claim a slam dunk success. But there is no slam dunk success. The SNP were humiliated then, accused of misrepresenting the analysis by spinning estimates as facts. They also implied that their resounding success was based on 40 different studies that backed the SNP's policy. That wasn't true. Well, they had to rewrite their public announcements. What is clear, crystal clear, is that more people, let me say that again, more people suffer alcohol-related deaths now than in 2018 when MUP was introduced. In fact, men from deprived areas are in fact more drinking more with MUP in place, and others are switching to spirits. And if we are ever to get a grip, people suffering from dependence should have the right to access treatment and rehabilitation. This approach, a right to recovery, is backed by frontline experts. In the time remaining, Presiding Officer, let me highlight another key area, our NHS workforce. We have seen another increase in the number of nursing and midwifery vacancies, which stand at over 5,600, and is worse across our rural and island communities. It is hardly surprising that the number of patients on waiting lists is over 800,000. This morning, I attended a Royal College of Nursing roundtable discussion with student nurses. Many students are actually mature students, including single parents. What was striking to me was that when a parent decides to train for public service as a nurse, then they lose their Scottish Child payment that Shirley Ann Somerville spoke so long about. So if you want to be a nurse in Scotland, then the Scottish Government will take away your money. Our nurses are the backbone of our NHS and crucial to tackling Scotland's health inequalities.
The member is concluding. Yes. Thank you, Dr. Gohani. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Ruth McGuire. Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking the organisations, community groups and others who have engaged with me in advance of this programme for government? I'm grateful to them for their dedication to the communities they support and serve. Because one thing is clear, as we talk about delivering equality, we know it is not something that can be done by those of us in this place alone. It requires the sharing of information, resources, expertise, and so much more. But another thing is also clear. Inequality and poverty are not inevitable. They are consequences of political and economic decisions and choices. So that is our challenge, to make better choices. The PFG we discussed this week is not going to eliminate poverty and inequality in one year. It is not possible to undo the structures and processes that decades, centuries of decision-making have created that fast, even if we had all the powers we need. And the UK's austerity agenda we've endured makes our task so much harder. But the PFG does signal a clear and important direction of travel. I and my Scottish Green colleagues are pleased to see the Scottish Child Payment at the heart of this year's PFG. When we argued for it to be so substantially increased alongside mitigation of the cruel benefits cap, we knew it was the right thing to do. But we didn't know quite how desperately significant it would prove to be in this crisis of costs and inflation. This crisis, let's be blunt, of greed and profiteering. Experts and academics, like those at the JRF and Danny Dorling, they agree the Scottish Child Payment is the single most important intervention in anti-poverty action. But it's not enough alone for the children of Scotland. Those 300,000 children have already borne heavy burdens in their short lives and face more in their futures. We must build on the foundation of the increased payment to provide the shelter that they need from the storms that assail them. Those storms include real damage to children's health for those who live in cold, damp, cramped or unfit flats and houses, or those who have no permanent home at all. We've led important work in protecting and enhancing the rights of tenants, work that, alongside practical action on homelessness, must be prioritised in the coming year. I'm going to make progress. Health burdens fall heavily, too, on the children who live and play and learn in streets blighted by air pollution. For some adults, low-emission zones are a political football, part of the so-called culture wars. But for children with asthma and other conditions, football in the streets can be a cruel joke, and the wars are literally a matter of life or death. Many of those receiving the Scottish Child Payment face, as well as poverty, particular injustices to do with who they are and who cares for them. We know that households that include a disabled person suffer disproportionately in this hostile economic environment. So I look forward to the implementation of the immediate priorities plan and to the further transformations which must flow from it. We know that Scotland still has a problem with racism, structural, institutional, yes, and also sometimes conscious and deliberate. Children, including gypsy and traveller children, face systemic and personal abuse and exclusion. The Anti-Racism Observatory is welcome and has vital work to do and to enable. We know that some of those 300,000 children who currently benefit from Scottish Child Payment will be transgender or non-binary. Many will be gay, lesbian or bisexual. We want them all to grow up in safety, with dignity and equality, with their health needs met in the right place at the right time, and with freedom from cruel and damaging conversion practices. I and the Scottish Greens will never renege on our solidarity with the LGBTQIA+ community. Some of the children receiving the child payment are refugees. Many others are callously excluded from our support by inhuman and often illegal UK laws and policies. I urge the Scottish Government to push the boundaries of the possible to mitigate those shameful acts and to welcome all children fleeing from their homes, whether from Ukraine or from other places of danger, conflict or oppression. And we know, as a dark backdrop to everything we do, that all Scotland's children face futures blighted by the effects of climate chaos. 2045 may seem a long time off in election cycles, but those who are babies now will only just be starting out on their adult lives then. Even the end of the century, the furthest reach of our everyday imagination, is a time that they can expect, should expect, to see and to experience. North Sea fossil fuel licenses might bring short-term gains for a few, but for generations to come, they are warrants of death. For the sake of those children and the families and communities to which they belong, the just transition cannot just be a technical project. They need, we all need, a future powered not only by clean energy, but by creativity, and most of all, by care. Every year of this Parliament, the context in which we work becomes more difficult. We act in the shadow of a Westminster government, shameless in its brutality, making no secret of its hostility towards our work, and a Westminster opposition, increasingly reluctant to oppose. I don't underestimate the obstacles we face, but we can do things differently here. We have a tradition in this chamber of cooperation across party lines, of attention to the common good, of imagining and working towards a shared, generous future. We have the opportunity this year, particularly in shaping our Human Rights Bill, to bring that future closer to hand. Let us grasp it with urgency, with compassion and with hope. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Colin Smith.
Presiding Officer, reducing poverty, delivering growth, tackling climate change and providing high quality public services are rightly the focus of the programme for government announced by our First Minister at the beginning of this new parliamentary term. I was pleased to hear the First Minister describe his agenda as unashamedly anti-poverty and pro-growth. The better, fairer Scotland and more equal society we'd all like to see requires our concerted efforts to both eradicate poverty, tackle the cost of living crisis, and create opportunities for businesses and individuals to thrive. Today, we debate equality, opportunity and community, actions to build stronger communities, improve social justice and reduce inequalities. These are the things that arguably will make the most immediate difference to the people that we serve. Like many colleagues from across the chamber, I spent recess in the communities I represent, doing additional surgeries and meeting with community groups and businesses, listening and providing assistance where I could. Of the many varied things that myself and my office team help constituents with, there is one thing that is the same, one thing that's constant, and that is how poverty exacerbates every single inequality and any injustice. People across Scotland have been paying a steep price for economic incompetence, austerity, and Brexit caused by successive Westminster governments for a number of years now. In the last 5 years, the Scottish Government has spent more than £700 million mitigating the impact of Westminster welfare cuts alone. But the current cost challenges, which are being noticed by all but a few households, are now a crisis, felt even more acutely, more keenly, and harder to overcome by those who already have the greatest challenges. Scottish Government action is making a difference to children and families in my constituency and throughout Scotland. Due to the policies of our SNP government, an estimated 90,000 fewer children are expected to live in relative and absolute poverty this year, with poverty levels 9% lower than they would have been otherwise. One child living in poverty is one too many, but there is progress there. The First Minister quoted the late David McClatchy's warning about worshipping the false god of consensus, and for the good of society where we need to pick a side in doing just that. There are two matters where I'll follow the First Minister's advice on that front. The first concerns the Care and Justice Bill. The aims and principles underpinning the bill are laudable. It's the right thing to do and absolutely supports keeping the promise. However, there is an undeniable challenge in balancing the rights of offenders against those of the victims who are harmed by offending behaviour. This is never starker than when both parties are children. From their casework, I'm sure MSPs across the chamber will recognise situations in which the balance has been off, has not felt just, and in which the harmed child has been further traumatised by the actions of our care and justice system. A system which intended to do its best for the child who caused harm, but particularly in cases where a sexual offence has been committed or where the harmful behaviour is coercive control and domestic abuse, has let down the victim and compromised their safety. That important balance of rights is not correct and the bill is drafted, and child victims will not have their rights realised if changes are not made. I'm hopeful that the Scottish Government will work with me, victim support and others to get this right, and appreciate the Children's Minister's willingness to meet. I hope we can get a date in the diary very soon. Finally, and again on the theme of justice and inequality and reflecting on how poverty exacerbates inequality and injustice, there are, as colleagues have set out, many measures to welcome for women in the programme for government. But I'm pretty dismayed, to be honest, to see no mention of legislation to tackle commercial sexual exploitation within the work on violence against women. For decades now, the Scottish Government has recognised that commercial sexual exploitation in all its forms is violence against women. However, our legislation does not protect women from that particular violence. It is a cause and a consequence of women's inequality, and in women and girls with the greatest vulnerabilities are most harmed. That men can buy sexual access to women in this country online and as quickly and easily as you might order takeaway food is shameful, and it fuels trafficking and abuse. And it doesn't just harm the women involved. There are wider societal implications for women and men. I would call on the government to do three things. Outlaw online pimping and the purchase of women. Hold traffickers and the male buyers and those who exploit and fuel demand to account with the full force of our criminal justice system, and provide a comprehensive financial support and exiting services for women prostituted and exploited. A fairer country for me will be one where no woman is bought or sold. where women and girls have equality, where their lives are not limited by misogynistic society, and the communities that they live in are safe and free from male violence. Any attempts to tackle the pervasive misogyny which harms so many women and girls, boys and men, will be futile if we close our eyes to this or look the other way because it's too difficult or there's not comfortable consensus at the moment. The equal society that we all seek demands actions, which I hope my government will take. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call Colin Smith to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A week ago, Scotland's long-awaited COVID inquiry got underway. We heard again those tragic stories from families who lost loved ones, more often than not, those in later life. It reminded me that a day rarely passed at the height of the pandemic when I didn't have constituents raise their heartbreaking experiences, not being able to see loved ones in a care home because we failed to get our act together over testing, social care packages being removed when they were clearly needed, the pressure people felt to sign do not attempt resuscitate forms, the loneliness, the isolation many older people faced, and of course the appalling death rate amongst those in later life. During that time I kept asking myself that when all the big decisions were being made, who, independent of government, but with real statutory powers and with the ear of ministers, was championing the human rights of older people and making sure their voice, their views, were being listened to? And frankly, the answer appeared to be no one. Now, Presiding Officer, that COVID crisis has been replaced by a new health and social care crisis, and it's those in later life who are again bearing the brunt. More and more older people are stuck in hospital when they should be at home but can't return there because we don't have the carers needed to look after them. Others are being moved out of hospital into care homes to manipulate the delayed discharge figures, often miles from their home and family, as more and more care homes close when all they want to do is return to their own home, but they can't because of the thousands of care worker vacancies across Scotland. One recent case I'll never forget was that of a constituent whose cancer had become terminal, who no longer needed medical intervention, just support from carers to make them comfortable. Their final wish was to die at home, but instead they spent their final days in hospital for no other reason than a lack of carers to deliver the assessed care package they needed. Presiding Officer, when we can't provide carers in such circumstances, it really does show how utterly broken our social care system is. So I welcome the decision by the government to ban the long-standing calls by Labour and the trade unions for a pay rise to at least £12 per hour for care workers, albeit 3 years after those calls were first made, so massively eroded in value by inflation, and it's still 6 months away. But we will not make serious inroads into that care worker recruitment crisis unless £12 per hour is part of a clear plan, a first step with a timetable to deliver £15 per hour and proper career progression for those who do that invaluable job caring for our loved ones as if they're their own. Presiding Officer, Scotland has a rapidly ageing population. It's grown at a faster rate than anywhere else in the UK. But increases in life expectancy have slowed. Too many are spending far too much of their later years in poor health, with poor levels of care, and a growing number are growing older in poverty. There's a misconception that all older people are wealthy, but the Scottish Government's own figures show almost one in six people of pension age in Scotland are living in poverty. That poverty is often hidden, many older people quietly getting on with their lives, not wanting to make a fuss. But pensioner poverty, which sadly doesn't merit a mention in the government's programme, is on the rise. We're in danger of another pandemic, one caused by the rise in the cost of living, a poverty pandemic, with, according to the charity Independent Age, 150,000 older people and rising, the victims of that pandemic. Yet in the government's programme published yesterday, older people barely register. There's one direct mention, a claim that equality for older people will be advanced by the government engaging with the Older People's Strategic Action Forum. I welcome any engagement with the forum, its members, but also the many other groups across Scotland who work with older people every day. But, Presiding Officer, that forum hasn't been convened by the government for 2 years. It's met just 4 times in 6 years. According to the Scottish Government's website, it's chaired by the Minister for Older People. Yet one of the first acts of the new First Minister was to axe having a minister with older people in their title, despite condemnation from members of the forum and others. This programme for government is a missed opportunity to really engage in the issues facing Scotland's older people, despite the ask from those working with those in later life being relatively modest. The reinstatement of a named Minister for Older People, a dedicated pensioner poverty strategy, the creation of an older persons commissioner, a real independent champion for those in later life with statutory powers. This week, Scotland's new Children's Commissioner began work, and we wish her well. There are Children's Commissioners in every nation of the UK, an older persons commissioner for Wales, one for Northern Ireland, and a growing campaign for one in England. Why should Scotland's older people not have the same right? Presiding Officer, it's little wonder that in their 2023 big survey of people aged over 50, Age Scotland found just 8% thought us decision makers properly consider older people's issues. And 2/3, that's up from 51% last year, don't feel valued by society. Too many of our older people face multiple forms of discrimination. Too often they're negatively stereotyped when we should be celebrating the immense contribution they make to our communities. And we should be putting tackling the issues that they face at the heart of government. Sadly, this programme for government fails to do just that.
Thank you. And I call Karen Adam, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has shown leadership on equality and human rights. And it's an inspiration not only to many here, but to others across this land and beyond, all over the world. And our First Minister's dedication to fighting for these fundamental causes gives me great hope. Where, after all, do human rights begin? Eleanor Roosevelt once asked. In small places close to home, without concerted citizen action to uphold them close to home, we shall look in vain for progress in the larger world. Wise words from the former First Lady and distinguished human rights champion, words which underpin our journey here in Scotland to become an equal, inclusive community, free from discrimination, our potentials realised and full of opportunity for all. Scotland is already making great strides towards equality than other parts of the United Kingdom. In 2021, the Scottish Parliament unanimously voted to incorporate the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child into the law in Scotland before it was challenged by the UK Government. That bill would have been the most important thing Scotland could do to protect the rights of children and young people. And I urge the Scottish Government to do all it can to bring back the legislation as soon as possible. When we passed gender recognition reform last year, the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights said our bill was a significant step forward. It was passed by a 2/3 majority of this Parliament, and yet again, our democracy and our progressive policies were vetoed by Westminster. Time and again, we march forward unapologetically on human rights, only to be thwarted by a UK government which is hostile not only to human rights, as we've seen with our vile illegal immigration act, but to any part of the United Kingdom which dares to do better. It should come of no surprise. Last year, the UK government brought forward proposals to repeal the Human Rights Act. Thankfully, those proposals have not made progress at Westminster, but this is the uncertain context in which the Scottish people find ourselves. It is for this reason, Presiding Officer, that I wish to focus my remarks today on the proposed Human Rights Bill in the programme for government. The Human Rights Bill is a significant piece of legislation which could give effect to a further 4 of the 9 core international human rights instruments of the United Nations. These would enshrine a right to work and to favourable conditions of work. It will cement the right to an adequate standard of living, including the right to adequate food and housing. In the context of a Tory cost of living crisis and with the world's energy and food security threatened by Russia's abhorrent war in Ukraine, the need to guarantee these fundamental rights has never been more acute.
Yesterday, the First Minister spoke movingly about his past and present experiences of racism. And while racially motivated hate crimes are declining, there were 1,468 racist crime offences recorded by the police in Scotland last year. We must commit ourselves by all appropriate means and without delay to a policy of eliminating racial discrimination in all its forms and promoting understanding between different racial, ethnic and national groups in Scotland. The abuse and discrimination faced by women in society is as perennial as it is pervasive. To the surprise of no women in the chamber today, this is particularly acute for those in the public arena. We discussed these issues at length on the Gender Sensitive Audit Board, but I want to say that I'm particularly proud that under Nicola Sturgeon's leadership, we introduced the first gender balance cabinet in the UK, and that under Hamza Youssef's leadership, we now see more women in government than ever before. And in his first programme for government, through the Human Rights Bill, we have the potential to enshrine non-discrimination, economic and social rights, and gender equality for all women in Scotland. Many people with disabilities face barriers which prevent them from participating fully in society. These barriers take many forms, from financial to physical to cultural. And with this legislation, we can make clear that disabled people have the same rights as non-disabled people and break down the barriers which prevent them from realising their human rights. Many other communities would benefit from having their rights recognised in this piece of legislation, including LGBT people. And on that point, I'm relieved to hear the government is bringing forward the legislation swiftly to end the abhorrent conversion practices. And I look forward to ensuring that the rights of LGBT people are included in the bill. With this Human Rights Bill, we have yet another opportunity to distinguish ourselves from the cruel policies of Westminster and be a beacon for human rights. This will no doubt anger the UK government, who are doing all they can to undermine any Scottish progress. £700 million has been spent in the last five financial years to mitigate the effects of UK government policy on the Scottish people. The suffering and harm inflicted on us day in, day out by this unequal union cannot be emphasised enough. The Scottish government are the ones who offer that real change. And they do so with a programme for government which is fighting poverty tooth and nail and is proud and unapologetic about progressing human rights. We have made great strides in building a modern, inclusive Scotland, but we must not and should not rest on our laurels. Giving effect in Scots law to these core international human rights instruments will build stronger communities, improve social justice, reduce inequalities and tackle child poverty. Presiding officer, the cost of the union is clear. It is a cost mired in inhumanity. In stark contrast, the Scottish Government show their commitment with this programme for government to the highest standard of equality for our citizens with true humanity. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to closing speeches and I call on Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And let me start by correcting the record, because I said it took 16 years for the SNP to act on the Independent Living Fund. Turns out it was 8 years. In that time, 800 people with ILF packages died, and the fund remained closed to new entrants, despite promises by Nicola Sturgeon. Presiding Officer, I think it's fair to say that it's been an eventful year in Scottish politics. When we came to this chamber this time last year, few people would have expected that we would be sitting through a programme for government with Hamza Youssef as First Minister. In fact, I have sat through 24 programmes for government. This has to be the worst. In fact, zombies have more life in them than this offering. More working groups, more task forces, more oversight boards, more recycling of old announcements, no action. They say that there are some days where years of political action take place. Well, this last year has felt like a decade has passed in Scottish politics. From cash in envelopes to police tents in gardens, from allegations of MI5 infiltration to camper vans, we are now clearly in the last season of the long-running soap opera that is the SNP government. But, Presiding Officer, I must admit I do feel for Hamza Youssef. This time last year, he would have had no idea he would be First Minister. And there are few people in this chamber who will not join me in realising just how daunting the task ahead of him truly is. because the fact is that after 16 years of SNP government, not a single one of our public services is stronger. Our NHS is in crisis and the economy is stagnant. Now, he might not have had a long time to prepare for this programme for government, but I already want to ask him, whose programme for government is this really? Is it his? Is this a leftover from his predecessor? Or is it really the Greens' programme for government? Now, I don't expect to receive an answer. Like so much with this government, secrecy and a lack of transparency guide the reproach. The title for this debate is equality. And there could not be a more timely topic. Because after 16 years of SNP government, Scotland is a deeply unequal place. In fact, inequality across a range of measures has simply got worse. Let's take the NHS. Our health service was born with the sole ambition to provide equal access to healthcare for everyone in society, regardless of their means. But the fact is that under the SNP government, the very principles of our NHS are at stake. We have the scandalous situation where well over 1 in 7 of our fellow Scots are on a waiting list. This means cancers going undetected. This means people living in pain, waiting for orthopaedic procedures. And it also means that those who have the means are going into the arms of the private sector, whereas those who do not have that financial option are left languishing on waiting lists. Presiding officer, the SNP have allowed a two-tier health service to become a reality, widening inequality. Statistics published yesterday reveal the brutal truth. Over 820,000 Scots on waiting lists, almost 80,000 patients waiting over 8 hours in A&E in this year alone, 27,000 patients waiting on mental health treatment, children waiting years to be seen whilst their mental health gets worse. But that's only one snapshot of the carnage in our NHS. In this year alone, it's been estimated that there's been over 3,200 excess deaths. For healthy life expectancy, premature mortality, coronary heart disease, cancer incidence, the gap in outcomes is at their highest point since the statistics began. That is shocking, and the SNP benches should hang their heads in shame. And what about the First Minister's targets for ending long waits? Set in 2022, he has already failed to meet them. Thousands of people are still waiting over 2 years. We all know that cancer is Scotland's biggest killer, but the 31-day target and 62-day target have not been met. And in fact, the 62-day target has not been met since it was set over a decade ago. A&E is overrun. Delayed discharge, something that the current Deputy First Minister promised to eradicate completely, is once more on the rise. And there are simply not enough GPs to cope with demand, and Audit Scotland said the government's target for more GPs will likely not be met. Under the SNP, social care is also going backwards. Too many people are waiting too long for assessments for care packages, and too many are waiting too long for the care packages themselves. Costs of care are rising. In SNP-controlled Glasgow City Council, they are almost doubling whilst we wait for the SNP to prevaricate about ending care charges, something they promised to do years ago in their manifesto, but not implemented, and shameful that that's not so during a cost of living crisis. And as for £12 an hour, we were asking for this 3 years ago. The difference then would have been a rise of about £3 an hour. With inflation, that would now be worth £13.83 an hour. So you are shortchanging them still by a total of almost £2 an hour. The cost of living crisis has eroded your offer in real terms. No, I'll take no lessons from you. Right? You've eroded their offer in real terms, and you are making staff wait till April. Shame on you. Presiding officer, NHS and social care staff have been let down. They've been let down by the SNP, from the scandal at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital, where the health board is in denial and locked in a war of words with the inquiry, to NHS Tayside, where the lack of action and toxic culture of cover-up fostered by the SNP has failed patients. The SNP have presided over a litany of problems in our NHS and social care. They can't be the ones we trust to fix it. The people of Scotland deserve so much better than this incompetent, out-of-touch government. Change is coming, and only Scottish Labour has the vision and the determination to get our country back together.
Thank you, and I call on Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I thought it was quite interesting to listen to the former First Minister's opening remarks in her contribution this afternoon, and I welcome them, because I do think our political discourse, and we've seen it this week from ministers, has become so defensive by SNP and Green ministers around their broken pledges and promises. And collectively, if we're going to solve some of these problems, and especially around equalities, they need to start to listen and work with parties. Yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
On that very spirit, to respond to a point that Dr Gilhaney made later about the Scottish, earlier about the Scottish Child Payment, the reason the Scottish Child Payment stops is because it has to be based on eligibility for UK benefits. So in the spirit of consensus, will he join with me to call on the UK government to ensure that they don't stop UK benefits to student nurses and we'll be able to keep paying the Scottish Child Payment?
Miles Briggs.
The Cabinet Secretary knows I'm always welcome at conversations we have. We don't have them enough, though. I think that's one of the parts I'm making. Cabinet Secretary and ministers across this government are just relying on Green votes now in this Parliament. That's fine, but they're making a mess of legislation as they do that. Short-term lets is a prime example of that. The deposit return scheme is another example. But I want to start on a note of consensus, with aspects around the programme for government which are welcome. Indeed, we've been trying to progress with ministers. The bill to finally address the unsafe cladding is welcome, and I look forward to seeing full details of that. I hope, like in England, we see hotels and public buildings included. The announcement to finally deliver a national allowance for foster and kinship carers is also a welcome step forward, but we need to see the detail on what that looks like. And as the former First Minister also stated, the wider policy agenda around delivering the promise still very much needs to be outlined and developed. And I hope care experienced young people will hear more from ministers urgently in the coming weeks on how these commitments to expand, certainly around expanding holistic family support services, are going to be delivered, as the request of Bernardo Scotland in their briefing today's debate included. And Paul O'Kane, I think, made a number of important parts and contributions to this debate around a cross-party consensus and the objectives we all agreed to and set out in 2017's Child Poverty Scotland Bill, which was passed unanimously by Parliament, setting targets. We all want to see the elimination of child poverty, and that's a priority, I believe, for all of us across the chamber. Presiding Officer, in the time I have today, I wanted to return to an issue which hasn't really been raised by ministers at all today or yesterday, and that is homelessness and the unacceptable situation in Scotland we see and have seen statistically over the summer, with a record number of children and families who are now declared homeless and living in unsuitable temporary accommodation. When the Cabinet Secretary was appointed in April, I said we on these benches would work with ministers to help deliver solutions and develop those. To date, we have seen very little from ministers who seem to have failed to see the scale of the housing emergency Scotland is facing, especially here in the capital, but also to work to deliver an emergency response which is needed. Cuts to housing budgets and council budgets are the wrong answer. Yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
I just wonder how Miles Briggs reconciles what he's saying about his concern about homelessness and temporary accommodation with him and his party's opposition to any policy that seeks to avoid the loss of homes into second homes, short-term lets. How does he reconcile those positions today? Because it doesn't seem to me to be reconcilable.
Well, the Cabinet Secretary might not want to listen to me, but I hope she will listen to Alison Watson of Shelter Scotland, who says that the programme for government offers nothing new to meet the challenge of ending Scotland's housing emergency. She goes on to say anyone in Scotland currently experiencing homelessness who listens to the First Minister would have taken no comfort in his words. And the Cabinet Secretary, I think, should look in the mirror around her record on this, because in 2020, when 7,000 children were living in temporary accommodation, she said, I recognise we must go further. 2021, when 8,000 children were living in temporary accommodation, she was deeply concerned. 2022, when 9,000 children were living in temporary accommodation, this was a national priority. This year, we are now seeing a new housing minister who's very disappointed and deeply worried. That is a record of failure. No, I won't. I want to make progress. Thank you very much. But it is a record of failure and one which the new Cabinet Secretary needs to act on urgently to turn that situation around. Because every day in Scotland, 45 children become homeless under this SNP government. I don't have the time, I'm sorry. That's 9,595 children living in temporary accommodation across our country with no government plan to end that. Scottish families being accommodated in former hotels, guest houses and bed and breakfasts, many left sharing toilets with strangers and cooking on kettles. In so many cases, this isn't just temporary accommodation, it is inappropriate accommodation. Today we see a situation escalating out of control. The number of homeless applications have increased by 9%. 16,263 children assessed as being threatened with homelessness. The number of children in temporary accommodation at a record level. This is this record of this SNP government, and it is shameful. Now, children who have been homeless for 3 or 4 times more likely now are to experience mental health problems. Children who have been homeless are seeing increased risks of ill health and disability, up by 25%. And any teacher will tell the Cabinet Secretary, if she would listen, that children in temporary accommodation are struggling to maintain relationships and are experiencing increased anxiety as well. Now, we need to see a completely new approach to this from the government. And I hope, I don't have the time, I hope that ministers will genuinely use this debate and this new session to do something differently. Measures to prevent homelessness are already on the statute. We do not need the housing bill to take those forward. They're just not being delivered by local government because they don't have the resources to do that. Now, to conclude, Presiding Officer, homeless charities across Scotland are raising the alarm. Cross-party voices are raising the alarm. There is a growing concern around the housing emergency we face in Scotland today. We need an emergency response from this government now. We need to see a fresh leadership from the Cabinet Secretary. And I hope she will genuinely lead from the front on this, because it hasn't been mentioned in any debates so far. It is the biggest issue the summer minister should have been dealing with. Yeah. If ministers genuinely want to take forward a progressive agenda around this and the housing emergency, they will have our support. But they need to act, because we are seeing this crisis develop ever more, every day.
Thank you. And I call on Michael Matheson to wind up. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I've listened to all of the contributions in the course of the debate this afternoon. And I must say that I do think that Miles Briggs has managed to finish on a high point for the contributions from the Conservative benches here this afternoon in his desire to try and find a new way in which to try and tackle some of the challenges which we face as a society. And I can assure him that there is a determination and a willingness on these benches to engage in a constructive way where there are constructive suggestions to try and tackle some of these issues that we face as a society. I must say as well that I have also sat through 24 programmes for government in this Parliament, and I think my memory serves me better than Jackie Bailey's, whose memory I can only suspect has been clouded by time in this establishment. And my recollection is that the worst programmes for government were the first 7 that we had within the Scottish Parliament, which she obviously had a hand in. They were vacuous, lacked in ambition, and they were actually so unambitious. They actually left money in the bank account of the Scottish Executive at the time, which they handed back to Westminster because they weren't even capable. Capable of investing in tackling poverty in Scotland between 1999 and 2006. So I can recall poor quality programmes for government. Let me finish my point and I'll let you in. But I can remember very well the lack of ambition from our government. And I recall well, actually, at Jackie Bailey holding office in a portfolio that responsibility for tackling child poverty, but at the same time handing money back to Westminster because you couldn't use the resources to tackle effects here in Scotland. I'll give way to Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much.
Jackie
and
Bailey.
I am so grateful to be able to remind the Cabinet Secretary, because clearly his memory has faded too. Because when we were in government, our ambition to end child poverty saw 200,000 children lifted out of poverty in Scotland. Poverty, child poverty, went up under your watch, under the SNP, and now your ambition is to lift 90,000. Where is your ambition, Cabinet Secretary?
As ever with Jackie Bailey, let's just wipe out the reality of UK government austerity and the impact it has on child poverty. That's the impact. Started under Gordon Brown before he left office. The austerity programme and child poverty starting to increase as a result. Presiding Officer, however, the consequences of political choices in tackling things like child poverty are really important. So we have gone from a point where we have a Labour Party who has stated that we do too much social policy. Yeah. Too much of this social policy stuff and not enough on the economy. Then they tell us, you're not doing enough social policy to tackle poverty in our society. Yeah. And then they tell us we need real action on child poverty, but we don't need any of that social policy stuff to deal with it. And then, of course, the Labour Party, we're doing too much social policy, then we're not doing enough social policy, and now what we get from them is that we are now the champions for the rape clause and for the benefit and the bedroom tax. They're the party that are now supporting these policies. And to add to it, Presiding Officer, they have a shadow chancellor who has now said that they will follow the fiscal policy of the existing Tory government if they get into government next year. Now, it would be fair to say, and I think I'm being generous to them here, it's a bit of a muddle for the Labour Party nowadays, because I think in reality it is nothing more than a self-contradictory
mess. Let's hear Mr. Matheson, please.
A self-contradictory mess you've got yourself into on social policy and economic policy, which is reflective of a leadership in the Scottish Labour Party that don't have a principle to stand on when it comes to tackling these issues. And let's just remind ourselves of the policies that Labour have now wedded themselves to as well. So the two-child limit, what does it affect? It affects 80,000 children in Scotland. It takes £341 million out of Scottish families' pockets each year. And of course, we also heard from the Conservative Party, your new buddies, when it comes to social policy. We heard from Megan Gallagher, who said what we need a big, bold idea. Well, here's a big, bold idea for you. So the UK government...
Through the chair, always.
You could, Presiding Officer... Ms Gallagher and her colleagues in Westminster could, with the flick of a pen, they could lift 70,000 people out of poverty, including 30,000 children, by simply reversing the cuts they have made to benefits. Absolutely. That's the type of big, bold idea that would seem to me to be a good policy to pursue, rather than coming in here and pretending that you have a concern about the impact that austerity is having on local services within local authorities. The architects of UK austerity sit in those benches and in those benches. And the consequences that you refer to are the consequences of the policy decisions that your government is making and the impact it's having on communities right across Scotland. So don't come in here. Don't come in here and lecture us on the actions that we should be taking to tackle poverty, because this is a government that is doing exactly that with one hand tied behind our back because of the impact of your own policies at a UK level.
Can I remind the Cabinet Secretary to always speak through the chair, please? Thank you.
I will, Presiding Officers. Let me turn now to the issue of our NHS. So here we are in a situation where, if you were to believe what has been set out by the opposition parties, that in some way the challenges we have within our NHS here in Scotland are unique to us, that they only happen here in Scotland because of our actions. So let me be quite clear. When it comes to things like waiting lists in the NHS in Scotland, let me just do some comparative work here for Ms Bailey and her colleagues, Presiding Officer. So in March this year, in Scotland, there were on average 114 patients waiting per 1,000 of our population on the treatment time guarantee. How does that compare to what was happening in England? Well, using the same basis, it was actually 130 patients who were waiting. And of course, what was happening in Wales? It was 237 per 1,000. Now, I'll be generous here, do I for one think that Labour in Wales don't care about the NHS? No, I don't. I believe that they care about the NHS, Mr Smith. And they want to...
Can I just... Cabinet Secretary, I'd just like to ask all members to please refrain from intervening from a sedentary position where they are able to do otherwise. Cabinet Secretary.
I'm more than happy to take an intervention from Mr Smith if he wants to make one.
Matheson, you are the
Colin Smith.
NHS Minister in Scotland. What do you think your constituents think about lying in a trolley in your local hospital because waiting lists have gone up to record levels on your watch, Mr Matheson?
You see, that's why we put a recovery plan in place with an extra £1 billion in order to address these issues. But what the bit that Mr Smith doesn't want to recognise is the challenges which our NHS is facing off the back of the pandemic. Yes. The challenges we're facing with increasing demand on our healthcare system, they're not unique to Scotland. They're actually impacting on the healthcare system right across the whole of the UK and actually globally. And if Mr Smith is particularly concerned about performance, he only has to look at Labour's performance in Wales, which is significantly worse than it is in Wales. But he can be assured that we'll continue to do what we can in order to address these issues as we move forward. I want to turn to the issue of alcohol-related deaths, which was raised by Mr Gohani in the course of his contribution. And he made specific reference to minimum unit pricing. Now, I can remember a time in this chamber when the Conservatives had a sense of commitment to tackling what is three people dying per day from a preventable cause when Jackson Carlow gave a commitment to supporting minimum unit pricing. And he did that despite the fact that you had, as a party, as a position, presiding officer, the Conservatives had opposed the initial attempt at minimum unit pricing and decided to turn it into a party political issue. That was a position... No, I make this point again because I was on the committee that dealt with it and I witnessed the behaviour of Conservative members on that committee that resulted in expert witnesses refusing to come back to Parliament and give evidence because of the behaviour of Conservative members on that committee at the time. I won't mention who they were, but it was recorded and set out at that time. And Labour, of course, opposed minimum pricing, a position that was taken by Jackie Bailey. They orchestrated an alternative commission under Brian Fearon to come up with alternative proposals that fell flat on their face under scrutiny before the Parliament. The consequence of that was
getting
minimum
Secretary.
Unit pricing through Parliament. It was delayed as a result of the actions of the opposition parties at that particular time. And that was a reality and the consequence of what is quite clearly a public health policy that would make the situation, if we didn't have it, would make the situation even worse than it is today. And I say to Sandesh Gohani, I think you do yourself no favours and you do your party no favours by seeking to undermine a public health policy that many evidence-based leading experts have repeatedly said is making a positive impact in tackling this issue. And if Myles Briggs is to be taken at his word, he may want to have a discussion with his colleagues within the health portfolio in his party. Because if we are to try and tackle some of these very deep-seated inequalities in our society, then we need to take forward action on a collective basis, recognising the evidence that underlines the benefits of these policies, rather than to try and seek to undermine them for narrow party political purposes.
Mr Gohani.
Officer, I'm conscious of time. And drawing my remarks to a close, if we are to tackle some of the deep-seated health inequalities that we face in our society, we also have to recognise the social determinants of many of these inequalities. And one of the most significant social determinants of inequality and health inequality in our society is that of austerity. Mm-hmm. We have sought over the course of a decade and a half. History has shown us repeatedly the impact the economic austerity has on those in our most deprived communities. We as a government are determined to grow and expand our economy for a purpose, yeah. to invest in our public services, yeah. and to make sure that we tackle the root causes of those social inequalities within our society. We may not reap the benefits of those in our health service today, but we will in years to come. The question I ask those across this chamber is, are you prepared to, as a party, work with us in order to deliver that? Because it's very clear from the approach that's been taken by a Tory government at Westminster, tackling social inequality is no longer a priority. In fact, expanding social inequality appears to be the objective. And the sad reality is that a party that once said that it believed in strong social policy is now following the path of the Conservative Party, following the path of austerity, following the path of the rape clause, of the bedroom tax, yeah. of policies that push families and households into poverty, the policies that we know will drive social inequality and will create health inequality in our society. Well, one thing, President Officer, this government will do is we'll stand up to tackle social and health inequality in our society, and this is a programme for government that will deliver that.
Yeah, well done.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on equality within the 2023 to 2024 programme for government. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 10340 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 10340 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 10300 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a Stage 2 timetable. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
And move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 10300 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 10301 on Office of the Clerk, 10341 on designation of lead committee, and 10342 on suspension of standing orders.
All three moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And the question on these motions will be put at decision time. And there are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Megan Gallagher is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Paul O'Kane will fall. So the first question is that amendment 10343.2 in the name of Megan Gallagher, which seeks to amend motion 10343 in the name of Shirley-Ann Somerville on equality within the 2023-24 programme for government be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.